Welcome to Catholic Homeschool Radio, where we begin conversations to help parents enrich their lives and make practical decisions for the future.
First of all, let us say a prayer. You know, Saint Ignatius never started any work without saying, "Ad majorem Dei gloriam," to the greatest glory of God. So I recall my husband, 2 days before his death, who said to me, "I confide my literary bequest to you. If you find any word or anything which is not in total agreement with the teaching of the Church, burn it." I loved him for it. So the question is, I hope that I'm not going to say anything which is not in agreement with the teaching of the Church. And if I say something true, it comes through me, not from me. It's crucial to keep that in mind. Now, the beautiful topic that we're going to discuss is the role of women in the Church. We all know that we are living in very severely troublous time. We live in a sick world, and it is crucial when a patient is sick that the doctor gives a proper diagnosis. What is happening that the world should be so decadent, should be so troubled, should be so worrisome? And I'm going to give a very simple answer. And the answer is because women have a key role to play and they have betrayed their vocation. Now, in order to shed light on this, it is wise to start with Genesis. And Genesis is one of the most important books of the Old Testament. We are told us about the creation of the world. God is a creator of all things. He's not a producer, he's a creator. And everything came from him. Now, you will notice that you read Genesis that there is a whole hierarchy. It starts with inanimate beings. Beings that are his creation, it's coming from his hand, but they are inanimate. The next step is created beings that are animated, they have life. But then once again, there's a tremendous hierarchy. First of all, you have living things, but they're just a lower level. Take, for example, the loveliness of a daisy. It is God's creature, but it is incapable of motion. Then comes a higher level, which is animated life and motion. And you find this in animals. And against in the whole hierarchy of animals, that obviously a cat is more higher level than an insect. And then comes the amazing thing that God at one point says, "And now let us create a being made to our image and likeness." Then comes a radical, radical difference between persons and not persons. Now here, once again, let us make distinction. God is a person. Angels are person. And now God is going to create a person who is simultaneously intimately linked to her body or his body. Now, this is a radical difference. Obviously, the most radical is between God, the creator, and person, and persons that are creatures, therefore infinitely inferior to God, but nevertheless made to his image and likeness. Now, the amazing thing, we read the Bible, that when, first of all, let us make man to our image and likeness. And then he creates Adam. And Adam is indeed a person, but he has a body. And then he claims it is not good for man to be alone. Therefore, establishes a crucial bond between personhood and communion, or personhood and love. And then he puts Adam in a deep sleep, and from his body creates the body of Eve. Adam wakes up from his sleep and sees her and exclaims, "Blood of my blood and flesh of my life," immediately claiming the admirable metaphysical union between man and personhood, and claiming that there is no hierarchy. You cannot say the male is superior to the female is superior to the male. Teaching for 37 years has taught me that the most disastrous questions are stupid questions. They make you waste a lot of time and they're meaningless. Who is superior, man or woman? It's an absolutely stupid question. And nevertheless, you're going to see that today it is a poison that has infiltrated our society. Now, why is it so? Because they are complementary and made for one another. Now, I repeat, when Adam saw Eve, he exclaimed joyfully, "Blood of my blood and flesh of my flesh," declaring their metaphysical equality. But he adds, and this is going to be the key of my term, "Thou art the mother of the living." Let us stop and marvel. He declares that there is a bond between woman and life. And this bond is so deep that any attack on a woman is going to be to an attack on life. And a hatred of life is going to be an attack on the woman. We live in a deeply sick society, and we just have to face it, not live in illusion that things are going to get better and better. They're getting worse and worse. No, we need a doctor who diagnoses what is our problem. And we desperately need it because we are very, very sick. And unless we find a doctor who is going to tell us that is the way to salvation and to recuperating. And I simply say it is simply because women have betrayed their mission. I'm absolutely convinced of it. We have the key. And I found out a Frenchman of the 20th century, his name escapes me, who said, if you want to know whether or not a society is healthy, turn to the behavior of women. Now, the very moment that a woman revolts against maternity, in this very moment you see the society is dying. Now, take for example the idea, the stupid idea, and I say the word stupid is too weak. Who is superior, man or woman? The question is so stupid that he who raises it should not graduate from grammar school. It is idiotic, because obviously a man is a man and not a woman. Now, one of the things which is very tragic, women have betrayed their role, and I claim that a Simone de Beauvoir, who unfortunately was very clever, because obviously the devil is not going to choose someone who is very stupid. She had a sort of brilliance, seemed to be very convincing. She was born, I believe, in 1908, and then met Jean-Paul Sartre, and they became friends, and more than friends, whatever you want to call it. And then, at one point, she wrote a book called The Second Sex. And this book was an overwhelming bestseller, translated in every possible language and praised as one of the great creations of the 20th century. And from page one, she declares that women are a second sex. They're inferior. They're inferior intellectually, artistically, whatever you please. Women cannot compete with men. Now, Simone de Beauvoir has discovered what is the key to this crushing inferiority. There is not a single woman in the history of mankind who can compete with the accomplishments of men. And being brilliant and edging on genius, is clear, maternity. This is the reason. Because a woman is linked and bound to her body. Number one, she speaks of periods as being already a sort of gene preventing women from being great. Because, you know, it's a burden, it keeps recurring, it can be create all sorts of pain and discomfort, and then comes maternity. No, it is a shame, it is an abomination that women are not given full freedom over their body. And therefore already, you know, when she was in her 30s or so, she favored abortion. She tells us that she's gone from one man to another because obviously she could not expect fidelity from Jean-Paul Sartre. But for some surprising reason, she never became pregnant. But she made it clear that if she had become pregnant, her first duty would have been to get rid of the child, an unwanted guest. That is a definition of a child, unwanted guest. And what do? You put him out of your soul, and you don't want to accept it. Therefore, you've got to realize what he's trying to do is to convince us the inferiority, the tragedy of women is maternity, and to wage war on it. And this has been going on now. And unfortunately, to my heart's sorrow and grief, she has convinced much of Europe, and now more and more of the United States, that maternity is a burden that must be controlled. For example, I was giving a talk in Washington, and for some reason, the Belgian ambassador to the United States came to meet me. He knew that my grandfather was a famous man in Belgium and was interested to see me. It's a sort of curiosity. And we started talking, and then he said to me, you know, one of the greatness of contemporary Belgium is that we control birth. And he says, we've got to realize that it was an unbearable burden to women. And so now today, we have 1.5 child pro family. And I mean, this is one of the great achievements of the last 50 years. And I said to him, do you realize that Muslims are invading Europe and have 7 or 8 children in average? And do you realize that within a few years, Berlin is going to be a Muslim city? I said, don't you understand? We are just killing Europe. Very soon Europe will disappear because it will become Muslim. And he says, well, that is a price that we have to pay in order to liberate ourselves from the burden of maternity. And it makes my Belgium was a very Catholic country when I was a child. Churches were packed. Now about 7 to 8% of Belgian people go to Mass on Sunday. It is simply, you know, this is passé. This is precisely what is presented. And you see this. This is, to my mind, the collapse of our society, that women have betrayed their mission. And the amazing thing is that when women betray their mission, in some way, the victims are men. Because when a man no longer meets a woman worthy to be called a woman, am convinced that almost inevitably, directly or indirectly, it's going to lead to homosexuality. Because men no longer find they complementary in women. And I mean, I simply have to say, we are on the brink of an abyss. And if God doesn't have mercy on us, you're going to see that a woman who refuses to be a woman, who considers that to be a woman is giving a slap in the face of the Creator. Now, you recall what I said in my previous talk, that the woman was created last, the peak of creation, number one. Number two, she was declared to be the enchantment of Adam when he saw her. How can a man today be enchanted about a woman who is ashamed to be a woman? The bring between them is disastrous. Number two, how can a man look up to a woman who has become his rival? And I mean, of course, she's defeated. So it seems to me that our mission today, I'm too old to have children, but you still have the joy of being grandparent. I can simply say, to live a life which expresses the joy of femininity and to try to be an abyss between femininity and feminism. Femininity is a keen awareness of the beauty of our mission, and to get up in the morning and say to God, thank God for having created me a woman. I see its beauty, I see its mission. I'm proud to declare myself to be the handmaid of the Lord. And simultaneously, by so doing, to discover the beauty of masculinity. I don't think that never in my life, and my husband played a role in this, to discover how admirable complementary are. They are meant for one another. They are meant to help one another. And I mean, why is it? And this is going to be my concluding words, that the most beautiful relationships that exist between man and woman are to be found in saints. Because a saint has a deep and profound understanding of the beauty of the femininity. The greatest friend of Francis of Assisi was St. Clare. The greatest friend of St. Clare was St. Francis. The greatest friendship that exists, St. Teresa of Avila and St. John of the Cross, the friendship that exists between Francis of Sales and Jacques-François of Chantal. And this is something that we have to do. The more there be a holy friendship, which means purity, which means a deep understanding of the beauty of the other side, and to sing God's glory together. This is the great mission that we have today. And I can't just insist sufficiently that if you have the joy of having daughters and granddaughters, that the radiance that you should express because you are women is a message which is not expressed in words, but is expressed by your very being.